Hi friends, today we'll be talking about the titration curve of a typical amino acids. We have talked about amino acids in our earlier videos where we have seen that a typical amino acid comprises of both amino as well as the carboxyl group. Now when these amino acids, they are titrated with, say for example, NaOH, there is a deprotonation of these particular amino acids. So here we'll be talking about a simple titration curve of the simplest amino acids in the series which we have, that is your glycine. So typical glycine, if you see, in a fully protonated form. So this particular structure represents a fully protonated form of glycine. If you start the titration, you will find that it gets completed here at around say pH 12 somewhere, and as the titration proceeds, there is an inflection point where you have completed the 50% of the titration of this particular amino acid corresponding to this particular point, right? So let us label this particular point where there is a complete dissociation of the COOH to form CO-. So here the amino acid, it occurs in its Zwitter ionic form. So Zwitter ionic form of amino acid is a form where this particular group has a positive charge, this has a negative charge, and now in this case the net charge on the amino acid is zero. So this particular point, this particular pH where the net charge on the amino acid is zero, is referred to as its isoelectric point, or we refer to as PI. So here approximately 50% of the titration, you can say, is completed. So here this particular point, it corresponds to the pH of around 5.97. A typical glycine will behave as a diprotic acid. You may see that there are two particular curves joined by this inflection point which correspond to the curve of a typical titration of a monoprotic weak acid like your acetic acid. But then obviously the properties and the way in which it is titrated, they are different. So here you can see you have a particular point here, yes, which is corresponding to say completion of the 25% of the titration is 50%, that is around 25%. A midpoint between this 50% and the 100% of titration somewhere here, corresponding to the pH of around 2.34, represents your first pKa, and second one here, it represents the second pKa, that is around 9.6. So basically what is happening at this particular point, that is at the pH of 2.34, you have a particular amino acid in these two forms. So say for example, you have 1000 molecules of amino acids, so 500 exclusively occur in this protonated form, whereas 500, they will occur in this particular form. And the 50% here, right, so this particular value, it corresponds to 2.34. So that is the pKa1 of the ionization of the first carboxyl group. For the amino group here, you have the second pKa, where this corresponds to a point where your amino acids occur 50% in the Zwitter ionic form and 50% in this particular form where there is a complete titration of the amino acid. If you look here, the total charge on the amino acid is +1. If you look here, the total charge on the amino acid is 0. So this +1 and -1, which corresponds to 0. And here, the total charge on the amino acid is -1. You can basically divide this curve into different regions. Say you have, say, let us call this as point A. Let me call this as point B. Say this corresponds to your point C, point D, and your point E. So this is how a typical titration curve, it proceeds. Now here you will find there are different regions where your amino acids, they can act as your buffers. So we know that buffer is defined as a solution which resists the change in the pH. So basically it has a reserve acidity and it has a reserve basicity. You will find that this can act as a buffer one pH unit below and above 2.34. So say for example between 1.3 and your 3.3, this amino acid can act as a good buffer. Similarly, it can act as a good buffer 1 pH unit above and below 9.6. So here you can say, for example, between 8.6 to 10.6, this can act as a very good buffer. This PI we can also calculate arithmetically, which is just the mean of these two pKa values. So if you talk about PI, the isoelectric point, it is your pKa1 plus your pKa2 divided by your 2. So you have 2.34 plus 9.6 divided by 2, which will give an approximate value of 5.97. So you can arithmetically also calculate this particular value of your PI. You can see here that below the PI, any pH value below the PI will give this particular amino acid a positive charge. So this particular amino acid below the PI, if you place it in the electric field, it will move towards the cathode because it has a net positive charge below its PI. Above its PI, this particular amino acid has a net negative charge. And so you place this amino acid in an electric field or in an ion exchange column, you will find that above its PI value, the net charge on the amino acid is going to be negative. Now the intensity of the charge will depend on how further it is from this particular value of PI. At this particular value of PI, the net charge is zero, and therefore the electrophoretic mobility of the amino acid at PI is zero. Okay, so to just check whether we have really understood the entire process of this titration of glycine with OH minus or NaOH as such, let us have an overview of some of the questions which are asked here. The first one says, which region mainly has this form? Now this you can see a fully protonated form. So here you can see the fully protonated form, it corresponds to this particular region, that is your region A. Yes, right there. The isoelectric point is represented by, again I repeat, the point at which the net charge on the amino acid is zero, the zwitterionic form, where it is not mobile in the electric field, called as the isoelectric point. It is represented by this particular segment, that is your C. The next one, where does the titration end? So here you can see it ends at this particular point, that is your E. Next one, which is the worst region which represents as a buffer? I told, when you have two forms, one which can accept the hydrogen ions H plus and other which can donate, when both are present, there it is a good buffering region. Where only one form is present, so there it is not a good buffering region. So the worst buffering regions you have, especially at this particular point C. So it is your C. Yes, it is at point A and point E also, where there are the worst buffering regions, because there are no alternative forms of that particular amino acid. The average net charge of glycine is zero at, again, a definition of the isoelectric point, it says your point C. The regions having the maximum buffering capacity, when you have the 50-50%, I told, so it is your B, so here, and you have this particular region D. So the one which has the maximum buffering capacity is your B and your D. The average net charge is +1/2, so +1/2 right here. So here you have +1, here you have 0, the midpoint of this is +1/2, so here, yes, it is B. And -1/2, so from here to there, so it is 0 to -1, so -1/2, it will be your point D, so it is at your point D. pH is pKa for carboxyl group, for the first case, so this is at your point B, and this for the amino group here, it is your point D, right. Right, so since you are able to answer all the questions which I answered on your behalf, we have completed the titration curve of this particular glycine. Now glycine being the simplest amino acid, there was no interference because the R group which was there, it was only hydrogen. So there were no ionizable groups which were present. So the only ionization which we could see was that of the inherent amino group and the carboxyl group. You have acetic and basic amino acids which have some other R groups, their titration curves essentially are different, and the values and the calculations of PI are also different. So let us keep that for our next upcoming video. So stay tuned with us for more in microbiology and biochemistry. Thank you.